Yes, thanks. Then there's
Okay.
also a search component. There's constraint satisfaction and game playing. And lastly, there will be reinforcement learning. And the field of reinforcement learning, oh no, sorry, the artificial intelligence is actually quite wide, very big. It is a makeup term to define a new concept that last time people don't know how to describe that. And last time, chess playing is considered artificial intelligence. But now the field has advanced so far, it has no resemblance to the last decades already. But these ideas are still relevant and useful in various applications. Like we're from Triple E, and our tagline is World of Opportunities, meaning that anything related to, let's say, control signal processing can utilize this concept as well. So you can see in this diagram over here. Yeah, so there is on one side is low level intelligence, there's high level intelligence. And there are various points along the way that transition from low to high. And the field is very vast. So in this slide, there will be the headings. If it's highlighted red, it will be for the core ideas. And if it is green, then it is just for extra, for your insight, for your own learning and enjoyment. But don't expect it to be on your quiz. Yeah. So I just want to be, value add to what already happened in the modules. So that is also one of our goals, to value add and not just parroting what the prof said. Okay, let's go. We have 4 points. So let's start. So first, agent and environment. So the definition is, we have this definition of agent environment. And because we want to distinguish them, we want to isolate these components because they are very useful as you implement all of these artificial intelligence concepts. So there are five categories that or five questions that you can ask in order to classify these agent or environment, which is first, is it what is the knowledge of the environment? Is it accessible or is it inaccessible? Full knowledge and partial knowledge. Is it deterministic or non-deterministic? So do the consequence of the action change, or is there something that you cannot really predict? So how do you understand this, like non-deterministic behavior? So when you see this non-deterministic, I think you should think of a distribution, right? A distribution is something that it's like rolling a dice. You don't know what come up, but you kind of know the percentage or what is the probability of getting something. So how is that defined? So I have one illustration here is if you play games, you will understand this concept of critical hit. Like sometime out of random that you get a very good damage, which is you cannot really control, but you know that it is there, some sort of distribution. And if you play, let's say this is law, right? So if you build a certain build, then you increase the percentage of getting critical hit. So this highlights the idea of non-determinism, right? The environment will change, like in the certain distribution, your action when you interact, no, not you, the agent, when the agent interacts with the world, it's also different. We'll have a certain distribution. There's episodic and sequential. So sequential is, yeah, one thing leads to another and it will affect the chain of action. But episodic is you take one action, and that is the end of the game, the end of the environment. There's also static and dynamic. There's because of the idea of a changing environment. Because sometimes that because we distinguish between an agent and an environment, because what we can control is actually the agent. We can tell the agent, we can program the agent in a certain way, and we kind of know more information about the environment than about, sorry, we know more information about the agent more than the environment. And as the agent operate in the environment, it can change, right? One example is that based on our algorithm, maybe it is limited by 10 hertz. Agent have to process the input in at 10 hertz. But the environment changed very quickly, very dynamically. So that is something that the agent have to be aware, right? There will be a certain lag or delay. It doesn't update as fast as the environment. And the last one will be discrete. Is it a discrete or a continuous environment? Or is it a discrete or a continuous action that the agent can perform? So even though I said that the agent and environment can be clearly separated, right? But ultimately the agent has to operate in the environment. So if the environment is discrete, the agent cannot really do continuous action, right? Because it has to operate in that environment. So yeah, so using these definition of an agent and environment, we can then classify various gameplay and environment that we can apply artificial intelligence in, right? So there's chess, space invader. So let's run through a few. So for chess, it's quite simple. You can see that it is discrete, one step at a time. One step at a time is very accessible. You see what your opponent do, the opponent can see what you do. Deterministic, because there is no dice, right? When you play Monopoly or other board games, you roll the dice. So it's non-deterministic. But in chess, if you fail, skill issue. Then, right, so that is chess. So let's say at the other end, the spectrum, right, will be your, let's say your StarCraft, which is a game that you have to drag your mouse in the screen. So even though dragging your mouse in the screen is like per pixel, technically you can still define it as a discrete, but because the pixel is too dense, right, we can kind of say that, okay, it's quite continuous. We can wave away the pixelated movement. So it is kind of continuous. The environment is inaccessible. You can see that there is fog of war, which is you don't know the environment. You can only see what you are, where your base is, right? So is it deterministic or non-deterministic? Right. So sometimes some unit will have critical hit, so it's non-deterministic. So this is quite a case-by-case basis. But using these classification, you can start classifying the various game environment. So now let's try to do some examples, because with the program we shared, yes. Yeah, so these are the various sample questions. I'm not sure if you have access to that, but this is something that your junior or your senior shared, and then I just adapted. If you have seen it before, then it is quite boring. So if you want something more challenging, you go back to the previous slide, right? Previous slide is more exciting. So driverless taxi, is it accessible? Right. It operates in the real world, and the taxi cannot really see, let's say, 10 kilometers away. So probably a false. Eh? Oh, I have to exit. Yeah, it is a false. So a slot machine, do you think it is a sequential environment or episodic environment? You can start, like, so this will be something that will be happen along the way as well. Is that I will try to do these questions with your help so that you can understand what is happening, how you should do this when you are in the exam. So slot machine is it sequential? Is it true or false? False. Correct. False. So Go playing require a dynamic task environment. Go is the disc game. This will be, which is, so this is true or false. The statement is true or false. So the statement is false. Yes. Chess is a deterministic environment. Yeah, skill issue. Yeah. Minesweeper is a discrete environment. Quite obvious. Yeah. True. Go is a discrete environment. Yeah. Square, a grid, discrete. And agent that says partial information about the state can be rationed. So if the agent operate in an inaccessible environment, is it rational? If it doesn't see what is happening out there, can it be rational? Yes, this can. So it operates with its information, right? It is true that it cannot understand anything about the world or everything about it. But given the information that it has, it can come to a optimal or near optimal conclusion within the certain, within the allowable constraint. So yes, we can think of that as rational. And yeah, so these are the various types of questions, quite standard. So this is the first part, which is the distinction between agent and environment. So down here, yeah, so you see that this title is green, which is, these are extra. You don't have to know this for your test, but I would like to share a bit. So this idea of separation between agent and environment can be clearly seen when you start doing this kind of problem in real life. When you do your FYP, when you go out in real life, is so there's this environment called OpenAI Gym. So if you follow your AI news, you can see that OpenAI company and reinforcement learning in general, they will be using this library. And in this library, you can see that there is a certain section of code that programs the environment logic. There's a certain section of code will deal with the agent logic. And they want to keep these two separate. And why do they want to keep these two separate? It's so that researchers who are focusing on the algorithm can work with the agent only. The environment is the same, right? Let's say in this game, the game is to land the lunar lander. So different agents, different algorithms will perform better or worse on this same environment. So this separation of environment and agent allows the researcher to rapidly test or benchmark the algorithm without caring about, you know, how complex the environment is. Because generally the researcher wants something general. Yeah, and you can see the discrete and continuous. That is where people define possible action. Okay, I think this is not important. Okay, so now let's go to search. So there are two types of search in this course. So there is a blind search, uninformed blind search, and then there is an informed search. So what does it mean to have a blind search? So when you have a blind search, you don't really have any other information, right? When you search, at least you have to know what you are looking for and the pathway. So if you recall the first day you come to school and you know that there's this corridor, there's this doorway, hallway, and you want to go to Triple P, but you don't really know the way. So the only thing that you can explore is to go down the hall, go down the doorway. So that is the only information that you have. So you are like searching the school, but you're searching blind. So now suddenly there are some signages saying that, oh, AAA school is this way. Ah, then now you have some information where you should search for AAA, right? So those are the distinction between blind search and informed search. But the minimum, right? At the minimum, blind search requires you to know if you are in the goal area, at the goal state. You have to know where, if you are, you reach your destination, and you have to know how you, at least you have, you need to know the hallway, the corridor to get to the goal. So how is that expressed? So usually it is expressed as a graph. So when you start out, you will go and visit the nodes, and you will know from a certain node, you will see various edges. So these edges act like hallway. You know that if you go down this edge, you will reach a new node, right? So even in blind search, you still need the edges, right? So these are the video showing the DFS, which is depth first search, and DFS breadth first search in action. So you can see that depth is, you go depth 1, 2, 3, you go down. And breadth is you go sideways. And what does it mean to go sideways? Go sideways just mean, so if you start out at this node, and you have three neighboring nodes, then you have to visit the neighbor first before you go down to the next step, your neighbor's neighbors. Yeah, so this is a sequence of action that you can do. And I think it is quite self-explanatory, breadth and depth. So now here are just some math or some classification. So is it complete and optimal? So if you breadth first search, right? If you just go one by one by one by one by one, yes, it will reach there ultimately. And when you can see that there's the time complexity and also space complexity. Time complexity is the time you need to reach there. So how do we classify this time? So let's say when you visit a certain node, you will take, let's say when you visit one node, you waste one unit of time. And for space complexity is the idea that when you visit a certain node, you have to remember the various available edges for your next exploration. And what do I mean by that? So let's see. So in this tree, like the tree is the same from the breadth first search and depth first search. Our worst case goal is this goal at the end. And this is the worst case. So the let's say convention is we go from left to right. But so if we hit the worst case scenario, we have to go here. Laser, notate, laser. Yeah, we have to go here, down. Right. So one, first is you have incurred one cost. Then B is your branching factor. So in this graph, one node branch out two other nodes. So in the next rung, there will be B, nodes. Then in the next one will be B square node. Last one is B cube node. Yeah. So space complexity is B to the power of D. So you can see that B to the power of D, which is the very last layer node, because as you explore your neighbor, right? If I'm here, if I'm at layer one, I visit this first node and these two nodes, I have to keep them in my memory. I have to know that, okay, these are my neighbors. I store them in my memory. So that I know that I have to visit them. But then after we finish with the first layer, we go to the second one. We can discard the neighbor, like I have visited you, you don't have the goal that I want. So I will start exploring your neighbor's neighbors. So now your working memory only needs to store the neighbor's neighbor, right? The second layer one. You don't need to care about this anymore. So the idea is that at every layer, you have to like constantly store B to the power of D nodes for exploration. Okay, how about DFS? So DFS is, in a sense, less intensive, but less space and time intensive, because it would try to go down first. It would try to go deep down. But the time taken will roughly be B to the power of M, which is roughly the same as this, because if the worst case goal is over here, right? No matter how deep you go down here, you have to ultimately reach over here. So yeah, B to the power of M, which is also the max depth where the goal is. But the difference is in space. So in the space area, B is B times M. So it's no longer, you don't have to remember the layers, the node at the same layers, but you have to remember the node down the chain, right? You have to remember the deepest node and the one adjacent it. So in a sense, so now branching factor is 2 and M is the depth, so it's B times M. So why do you need to remember this? Because you keep it in the memory so that you know next time you have to go back here, right? After you dig this hole down, all the way down, you cannot find your treasure. You have to go back up and then go down near the branch. Yeah, so that's the idea of having a space cost is the memory. You need to remember where you have to go next. And these are various, whether it is complete or not, I think I don't have any way to visualize it. Yeah, but I think it I hope it makes sense. So if it is infinite depth, right? If you keep digging down the branch and there's no depth to it, you will never go up and explore other branch. So yes, so these various paragraphs, I think you can explore in your own time. I think it can come out as a true or false or a statement kind of question. It might come out as a statement question, but not really something that you have to procedurally work out. Yeah. The chat. Yes. So blind search. So there's also cost to it. So uniform costs. So now, just now I said that one of the assumption of this graph is that all of the branches, all of the edge has the same cost in a sense. So now the difference in this case is that the branch will have costs. And the way we do this is that you have to keep track of this cost as well, because the cost give you additional information. And uniform cost search is the idea that you will do depth first search until the depth is not as good as the next breadth. How does it work out? So first, you see that your neighbor. So in a sense, let's think about it this way. Chinese New Year or any celebration, you have to go visit your relatives. And your relative is some kilometers away from you and you want to visit them. But how do you, let's say, optimize to do that? So you're here, you're in your home. Okay, you have three relatives, 15 kilometers away or miles away if you're American. So first of all, I visit relative A. Then I know that, okay, like after A, there is another relative, which is 11 kilometers away. So you have to prioritize going to B before you reach, which is 5 kilometers away compared to 11. Right. And now you discover another one, which is 10 kilometers away from you. So now you want to go deep, you go down here before you visit the one that is 11 kilometers away, right? Yeah, so I think that is the intuition, fun intuition. And there's a certain note, which is that sometimes the question might give a weighted graph. That is, there is note, there is number, but if they just ask for pure breadth or depth, just go with the what question wants you to do. Yeah, sometimes the number is quite misleading. So here is more expansion on the idea of depth first search, depth limited, or depth or iterative deepening. So all of these are all a combination of breadth and depth. So why do they have that? This depth limited? Because if you recall, one of the disadvantage of depth first search is that if the depth is so deep, you will not go back up again. So now we impose a certain limit saying that, okay, I need to explore three layers now before I dig deeper. Yeah. So I think it is quite procedural. Like if you know what to, if you know the sequence, then it should be all right. And they are all just a combination of breadth and depth first search. Search, perform search. Let's do this first because the questions are more relevant. So in the breadth first search expansion, after 1, 8, 5, what is the next one? So breadth first search, you are starting from here, 1, 8, 5, and the next one will be, 2, quite obvious. I don't know why they put it in the one of the example sample question. Yeah, not 5, not 2. So down here, right? What path would breadth first search return for this search problem? So you start from S, you end at G, right? So here they put in the number. Oh, X is like 12 units away from G. A is 1 unit away. But what is the sequence if you want to do it breadth first search only? Underline. So this is SG, SAGC, SABDG, SACDG. SG, yes, Singapore, yes. So it can be quite tricky, like you don't know, okay, like S, there is a neighbor that is A and G. So where should you go first, right? So there might be a question that put in like SAG, which is also valid as well, because technically you don't know which neighbor you will visit next. It's just that for breakfast, you have to visit the neighbor for neighbor first. But out of these solutions, none are SAG. So the only way is SG. So the path which depth first search will return problem, you start at S and you end at G. Right, so what will be the result? S here, G here. S A D H G, depth. Yeah, that makes sense. Any? Okay, I will. Yes, it's D. So this is the note that I write earlier, which is that there can be numbers, there can be weights attached to these nodes and edges, but focus on what the question is asking. Yeah, sometimes they get weighted, but ask for only pure algorithm. So now let's go to informed search. So yeah, so blind search will have to, you have to reach your destination before you can know if that is your goal or not. But informed search has other information for you to measure the distance toward the goal, right? And similar to uniform cost, you also need to keep track of this score. You have to keep track of the distance between to this point. So there's uniform cost search, which is what we have explored. We're just counting the cost that we have incurred, that we have incurred so far. There's greedy search, which is that you just follow what is the, that give you the best signal. And there's A star, which is the mix of both. So how does that work? So for example, so this one example of a straight line distance to various location. Yeah, so now you can have more information of the distance between your current state and the goal. So you can use that as the heuristics. The term heuristics just mean that there is some extra information that you can base your decision-making on. So for this example, the decision-making, you can rely on the distance. But the quickest way to that, to your goal, might not just be the distance. So that's why people use the term heuristics. It might look correct, because yeah, generally it is, but not always. So heuristics, yeah. So yeah, so if I want to go from Arad to Bucharest, where should I go? So I can see that Arad is like 366 away from Bucharest. So 0 plus 366, so I have to be at Arad first, and then I will have to expand, right? If I go to Shibu, then it's 4140, which is the distance, the cost, that path, and 253, which is the distance that is measured from Cebu to Bucharest. Yeah, so this, so, okay, I have to define this. Fn equals Gn plus Hn. So G is your path cost, and H is the heuristic. So this G in this case is 140, which is the edge cost over here. Okay. Yeah, so 140 is the edge cost, and 253 comes from the heuristics, the straight line distance, right? So these edges, I think, will define the distance, let's say using train, for example. But here is a straight line distance, like airplane distance. So ultimately, you have to go to from Arad to Bucharest by train. But having this straight line distance also guides you towards the better options. So that is the idea of informed search, like a star search? Yes. So how would one go about doing this is, yeah, you iteratively add the cost path, the path cost, and also the heuristic cost. So I think what they are doing here is, in a way, breadth first search, right? So from Arad, you will see what are your neighbors, right? I have three neighbors. Then I evaluate whether the score is low, right? I want to go in the direction that is lowest, right? So 25, 293, 447, 448, 449. So this, so if I go to Sibiu, the cost is less. So next stop, I will have to evaluate what happens in Sibiu here. And the same goes for these things. So next, I will have to go to So that is how you can like progressively work this out. Yes, is everything so far so good? So this, again, a green title, which is additional information. So if you have done your data structure, then you know that this is something that is quite familiar to you, right? So depth first search and breadth first search have different implementation, right? So breadth first search use a queue, basically saying that like, I visit one, and then there are two and three, right, two and three. But then after I visit one, I can just remove one, just remove like sequential. But then if I do a stack, right, then every time I look at one, I discover two, and then I discover four. So it will stack up like this. So it is only after you visit four, then discard it from the pile, from the stack, then you can discover something else. Okay, basically extra information. All right, so I hope the first two sections, agent and the search, make sense. So now let's go to this point of constraint satisfaction, right? So constraint satisfaction, in constraint satisfaction, I think we will define these two terminologies that will be very helpful and to keep in mind. So first is a variable, right? And a variable can have values. So variable X can have like one, two, can be one, can be two, can be three, can be four. Right? So variables and values. And the objective of this constraint satisfaction problem is that you have to find a set of values for your variables that satisfy all of the constraints. Yeah. So, and this solution, so the set of values, you can call it a solution. But this solution doesn't have to be unique. Yeah, it doesn't have to be unique because there are many ways to solve the same constraint problem as well. So what does that mean? So this diagram here, what it is representing is the problem of a four queen. So in the chess, you know that queen can go left, right, diagonal, left, right, up, down, diagonals. So the problem over here is, how do you place four queens in this chessboard such that they will not eat each other? Yeah, they will not attack each other. So let's say you start out as blank. Then you will see, let's say, okay, like put one queen here. Then I will like iteratively like put in more and more and more. And then there are only a handful of possible solutions, right? But then I have to go and check whether these are good solution or not good solution. So you can see that it is kind of like a brute force method, right? You have to try and see if it works or not, which is which can be computationally intensive. So therefore people come up with the various techniques, say backtracking, depth first search with constraint checking. So basically, yeah, brute force, I put a queen here. And for the next step, I put one side by side, doesn't work. One diagonal, doesn't work. In a horse, like an L-shaped pattern, okay, it kind of works. Then I discovered something more. Yeah, like doesn't work. So this branch is gone. Like, I don't need to care about this. I go back up, go down here. So it is very brute force, right? So even though it is called backtesting, it sounds like a technique, but the technique is quite straightforward and still kind of brute force. So therefore, people can also come up with the term, the idea of forward checking. So what forward checking is, you exploit the probability, the property, you exploit the property of your constraint to stop the brute forcing. So that is the idea of forward checking and like constraint propagation as well. What does that mean is, if I know that the queen can go diagonal and sideways and go down, so next, the next check, I will not put a queen next, right next to it, because I know that this will, it will not work. So why do I bother check this operation? This is one wasteful operation that I need to check. Yeah, so the idea is, I put a queen here, then I know that this row, this diagonal, this row is all gone. So next time, if I want to check, I would have to place it elsewhere, right? More strategically. So this is the idea. So how will you be tested on this? I'm also not sure. Many problems can be defined as a constraint satisfaction problem. But generally, if it is in your lecture notes, probably they expect you to familiar with it somewhat. So here is like a four queen, maybe a more bigger problem is like five queen, but five queen, six queen, I don't know. Or there's another problem, which is map coloring. So you, let's say you have three colors and you have to color all states. So this is Australia. I think this is a map of Australia. New South Wales, Tasmania, somewhere. Yeah, Queensland. So you have this task of coloring a map, and what is the constraint? Is that two adjacent states cannot have the same color, right? So, but then you can see that there's also a formation which there are three adjacent states that also adjacent to each other. So they require like three color to color this thing, right? So in this case, the variable will be the color of the state. So we can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there are seven variables in this problem. So what are the values? The values are RGB, right? Three different colors. And now our problem is to find out way to color them all so that it can be satisfied. And you can see that. So we start from here. So before we start, all of the variables can exhibit any color, right? But the moment we decide that, okay, like WA is red, then it is red, then the adjacent one will lose the red values. So now what do we do next, right? So the next step can be NT will take green. Yeah, so now you have red and green here. So SA and QT will only have blue. And for the next one, I might go with blue. But because if I go with blue here, then I use up all the color that I can do, that I can use to color this SA. Right. So these are the various ways that you can go about doing this. So how will they test you on this? I really don't know. Like, especially if it's an MCQ question. If it's like written paper, you can propose a solution. But if it's an MCQ, maybe they will give you like which are the correct answer, right? But if you have a correct answer, all you need is to check if the constraint is satisfied. So there is less discovery. Like, you don't have to discover anything. You just have to check whether the constraint are satisfied. But they can, I think they can have, they can ask you the various questions that relates to the various techniques on how to solve this problem more efficiently, right? So one of the techniques or strategy to do this coloring problem, for example, is to focus on the variables. One of this is, yeah, so now I have colored these two states, then which variable, which states will I color next? Do I do SA or Q? So the idea is, okay, like you see SA can have only one color, while Q can be red or blue. So because this is more constrained, because it adjacent a lot of states, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 states. five state, including it is six. Yeah, so it is influenced by a lot more. So the better algorithm or like a better technique will be to color SA first, right? Choose the variable that has the smallest. Oh shit. I'm sorry. That has the smallest possible values. Yeah. So I think just stick with the idea of variables and values. Forget the domain. So this is, we tackle the variable. We focus on the variable. What about we focus on the value? So let's say I know that I want to color Q. So what color should I color Q? Given that there are like two options. I can do red or I can do blue. So which values? So one way to discover whether or not I color which values to choose is to see the consequence of that allocation. Right? If I color Q here, then the adjacent, right? The adjacent state will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 allowable values. But if I color blue here, then NT and SA are adjacent WA. So they have to take in a different color, green. So now I have 1 green, 2 green, red and green. So it's 4 allowable values. And definitely, if you have 6 consistent values, you have more leeway to play around. So that's why you choose, in this case, you choose the left. Yeah, consistent, least constrained value. So it's either least constrained value or most constrained variable. Yeah. Yes. So what are the questions? So these are the questions that are given to me for this lecture. And you can see that they are like very obvious. Is yeah, you consist a set of variables which value can be assigned such that the constraints are respected. Well, that's just the definition. And which is a more constrained region in the map coloring problem. So here, they color each region as the same, but it's a different color. So there's not much of a constraint here. But if you are to restrict 3 colors, like the problem just now, then you can see that the one in the middle have to adjacent, have to be nearby like the other 4. So it is the most constrained. Yeah, central and true. So, yeah, I don't know how it will be quiz, but if you understand the procedure or like what you have to do, I hope you can, you know, reason it out like step by step, step by step. Okay, so this is how do, so how do people embed the idea of a constraint, right? So what they can do is just using multiplication. So let's say if they put red and blue as 0 and 1. So if there's a constraint, right? So in this problem, this person have to choose blue, these people have to agree. Yeah, so there is a different inclination. And the way you impose the constraint is to multiply these, right? If R and B, right? So they have to agree. So R and B will have value 0. So the moment you discover that, okay, this constraint goes to 0, then that is a violation. Yeah, just something fun, right? So not in your exam, you know. It's just if you are to do constraint satisfaction in the future, then probably you have to use this kind of formulation. So you convert all of your description into a number, into an operation. Yeah, and they call it a factor graph. So something to know. Oh, and I'm not sure if this is relevant in some machine learning mod, hidden Markov chain. Yeah, so hidden Markov chain, like in a year 4 mod. So it's something fun for you to think about, but not in this exam. Okay, so now I think this is Minimax problem is more procedurally thing, right? You have to write down the thing. But so I think there are more to say in this case. Oh, there's a duplicate. Skip. So game playing, so mini max. So the idea of game playing now is we introduce another agent. So it's no longer you versus the world, but you versus the world versus some other. It's PvP, not PvE, right? Player versus player, not player versus environment. So the way we formulate this is also set up a utility score, like set up a certain metrics to make us know that we are doing the right thing. So this is, so I think this is a concept of rationality that we discovered like at the start. So if we set up a certain metrics, a certain score, then if the agent following the best score, we can generally say that the agent is rational because it is, you know, taking the best action. So we set up that score, and usually we will say that the score will favor us, so we want to maximize it. So this is quite arbitrary as well. Sometimes people can say it's a score, so you have to maximize it. Or sometimes people will say, oh, it's a loss, it's a cost, so you have to minimize it. It's based on convention, based on your definition. But in this case, you maximize the score of the game, and the opponent will want to minimize your own score. So in this case, you don't set up your own score, you don't set up the opponent's score. No, you set up only your own score. And you assume that opponent will do the best to minimize your own score. Yeah, so instead of keeping track of two things, now keeping track of one thing, your score. And what is it? And this will be more relevant next slide, which is the idea that the score will propagate up the nodes. And the challenge is to evaluate to the engine. This doesn't reflect that, but this will, right? So the idea is you assume that the opponent is also rational, you as well. Opponent is also rational, you also rational. You want to maximize your score, they want to minimize your score. And both you and the opponent will have the ability to calculate the score of that state, right? The score of any state. And the idea is, in order to make a decision where you are, you have to look into the future. Like you have to, let's say, simulate. So this is how all of the chess engine do it. Like they simulate the various interaction in the future, let's say 100 step in the future. And then they see, okay, like the future step will have this score. And then they will propagate those score backward to your current time step. So that was what I meant by propagate the value up. Because usually we will use this tree-like structure to solve this minimax problem. And the way to do it is you go from bottom up. But the intuitive way is that this is the decision that you have to make at, let's say, time t equals 0. And then this is t equals 1, t equals 2, t equals 3. So in a sense, you are looking into the future. The score at the bottom is the future. So if you know the future, what should you do at your current state? So that is why we have to propagate the score up and up. So in this case, white, let's say white is our turn, and black is their turn, right? So let's go from the bottom up. So we have to decide which of these state is better for us, right? We want to maximize the score. So we propagate this up. This is 3. In this case, it's 5 - 4, 9. But then in the opponent case, out of these states, the opponent will want you to have 3 instead of 5 because it will be more advantage. They want to minimize your score. So when you propagate this back up, it is 3 here and -4 here. Then up here, you will know that, okay, I want to go max, take 3. Yeah, so in your own internal calculation, you are assuming that the opponent is also doing the min-max game. If the opponent is not doing the min-max game, then it kind of like throws you off balance. But it still favors you, right? So for example, in this case, correctly, the opponent should pick three, right? What happened if the opponent pick five? Then you say, oh, wait, this doesn't how I envision it to be, but sure, I can live with that, you know, fine. So how would you be quizzed on this? Is yeah, let's do an example. So yes, so you start off with these values, 1, 2, 3, 3 steps into the future, right? So blue here is where you are maximizing, red is where opponent is minimizing the score, maximizing it, right? So from these two, you want to propagate five up because you know that, okay, I want to take five, yeah, propagate three, right? So what you can naturally do, right, is you can go layer by layer from bottom to up. But sometimes you might not have the correct values or like you don't know these values. So will that hinder our own calculation, right? If you don't have perfect information of the future, for example, will that make our rationality worse, for example? So let's put these here for now. Let's continue. Propagate one step up. So here we want to minimize. So number three goes up here. Then here, you don't really know what is in here. But you know that whatever is in here will be smaller than two, right? Because it's either two. So if this is higher, if this value is higher, they will choose number two. But if this is lower than two, then they will choose that value. So you can put an expression in saying that, okay, yeah, smaller or equal to two. So you can just put an expression. Yeah, and then now when you reach the level of maximizing, yeah, you can see that, okay, like three definitely beats whatever is in. So you can still find out the answer. Yeah, so this is because of the space, because I'm lazy or like I don't know how to clump them up and still be presentable. So this is a better illustration of some people have done. So the idea is, so what I have done just now, right, was to sequentially work it up like layer by layer. But one of the strategy is to prove. So it doesn't have to evaluate all of the possibility that I shared. It can also do pruning. So what does pruning mean? So it means that, so you propagate this branch first, you propagate this branch. So similarly, you can see that like this number three here. Then when you start populating this branch, you can start seeing already, this is number two. So you know this is smaller or equal to two. Then you don't have to finish this branch. You can already compare this layer and make your decision. So you chop this off. You don't have to explore. So what I did earlier up here is the idea that I don't have perfect information and I still get the correct value. But what is expressing here is that technically it can know all of the possibility, but because it is doing branch by branch by branch, it can know, it will know to terminate earlier because it already has enough information to make a decision. Yeah, but the operation is still the same. You have to like propagate the value up and up and up. So just to do one more demonstration. So first you have to understand at which layer you are maximizing or minimizing, because it can be quite confusing, right? If you don't establish which layer is maximizing, which layer is minimizing, you might come up with a wrong answer. So it's just a careless mistake, right? So here we know that here is maximizing. This green thing here is maximizing. This are max. Yeah, so now I know that in the future, I will have 7 score if I go down, if I take this action, assuming that my opponent is also doing mini max. Yeah, so here the problem is very simplified. It is a tree, but for visualization purpose, the tree has only 2 branches. But in a game, in any game, the branching factor can be like hundreds of moves at any point. Okay, oh, it's only 8, and we're already at the last segment. Is everyone okay so far? Any burning question? All right, let's go. Okay, so this section is actually more troublesome, right? More troublesome than the previous section, because if you go on to do deep reinforcement learning or reinforcement learning in general, there will be much more techniques compared to the search or the constraint satisfaction up there. But I will try to make it as simple and actionable in your quiz as possible. So the idea here is, in our first section, we define the category of agent and environment. So now we are going to explore how does the agent and environment interact with each other. So this is one of the diagram that you will see when you do reinforcement learning, is that the agent take an action. The environment will turn out to be some other way. And it will give the agent the reward and the state. So the state here is an observation. The state here is the agent observation of the environment. So if we go back, if the environment is inaccessible, right? If the environment has 10 variables, let's say position x, y, z, bro, pitch, yaw, acceleration in x, y, z, 10 variables, for example. But at any point in time, our agent is a plane and it can only measure the speed. So it can only see the velocity in x, y, z. So what it sees is only a 3 variable state. Yeah, so now you see how the control theory goes into this agent, is that the environment, the real world, is very chaotic and a lot of things. But your measurement, your sensors can only measure a few things. So the environment is inaccessible. Yeah. So the objective is to maximize the reward as you operate in this environment. So you see, like, in the environment, it will give the reward to the agent from time to time. And this is something that if you are doing reinforcement learning, you have to define. But in the context of the quiz, probably they will give you the concrete number. Okay. Markov decision process. Yes. So now it is a different visualization. There are various ways to visualize problem. Don't worry. I will make it relevant to the quiz soon enough. But my point is just to show that. So on the bottom right is one simplified problem that you might encounter in reinforcement learning, which is a grid world. So what the grid world does is that, let's say you start at some square, some grid, and you want to go to the goal state, and there are, let's say, obstacles or punishment along the way. So the question now is, how would my agent know how to go towards the goal state? So, oh yeah, I missed out this idea, but reinforcement learning is behind the various advancement in AI, such as your AlphaGo, AlphaZero, if you have heard, AlphaGo to play the Go against Lee Sedong, and AlphaZero is like playing, AlphaStar is playing StarCraft, and Alpha, I don't know, playing Atari, like, a lot of things. So they are employing reinforcement learning to play games. So even though this, the course will not teach you AlphaGo, but this is the underlying idea. So the idea is that the agent is allowed to explore the environment time and time and time again. All those AlphaZero, AlphaGo has run through this like millions and billions of times in order to know what is the environment and how to operate in it. So what are the values here in different square? So you can think of these as utility, right? If I go to this square, is it a good square? Is it a good, does it give me a good score? Does it give me a good utility, right? So this is the big picture of this current grid world problem. So what are these round shape thing? So this round shape thing is, you can think of it as a state transition. So now I'm gonna link back to ED, digital electronics. If you study digital electronics, this is like similar to your state machine. So you have to go from one state, you can take another action to move to a different state. So it is kind of state machine, but not quite. It's just that the visualization highlight that fact, right? So from going from the bottom square to a different square will be a state transition. Yeah, but up here, when you look in top down, it is the action is going up. Yeah. Okay, how will this work? Yeah, so from a state, you can have various action to go to different states. And there is probability, right? Again, the idea of probability and non-determinism, because let's say here from you are from S0, you want to go to S2, you take action A1. Oh wait, action A1 is 1%, 100%, never mind. You go to S2, and now you go when you want to go back to S0, take action A0. But 40% of the time you get to where you want to be. But 60% of the time you return back to S2. So this is the idea of a state transition probability. Sometimes you can reach the destination you want to go. Sometimes you cannot, even though you take the same action. Yeah. So the idea of a state, of an action, of a transition probability, or transition probability. And there's also a reward as well. But then I will show how will the reward be relevant down the line. And then the solution is to find a policy. So as the agent move around this world, the policy will be improved, right? And in the future, it will take better action, better decision. So as a heads up, most of your calculation for the quiz will probably only concern the first four or at most three, right? Three or four of these up here. The idea of a policy is not needed, right? I think it is not needed. It's quite advanced. But for complete sake, right, the policy is the thing that will improve over time, that gives you your AlphaGo, AlphaStar, AlphaZero, etc. Okay, so here is the main calculation I did, which is expected utility. What is it? Expected, this term expected. You learn it in your math one, yeah, math one, probability statistics. It's just a mean, average mean. You have a various X, then each of those will have a certain probability. What is your expected value, right? Expected value of the term X. So why do I use this word utility? So this term utility is important in reinforcement learning. But the idea is we want to, so if the utility follows a certain distribution, we want to know what is this expected utility. Why is this the case? Because it is true that let's say you want to know more about the world, right? You want to know more about the world. So let this. So if a die is rigged, like if a die is not fair, you would want to know the probability distribution of the various phases, right? So that you can make a more informed decision, right? So someone wants to make a bet, and then if you roll number six, I will give you $1 million, and then they give you an unfair die. You will need to know, you naturally want to know what is the distribution so you can make better decision. But in this case, like generally in real life, in artificial intelligence, knowing the distribution can become tedious very quickly, very fast, because you have to remember that in your memory, which is not good. So the idea here is to use the same strategy that we have been using so far, which is condense all of the information into one single number, the utility, and make decisions from that one single number. Right, so that's why we are taking the probability. Okay, now back to the calculation, right? 20, 10 probability is 20%, 80%. 20 times 0.2 is 4. 0.8 times 10 is 8. So the expected utility of taking action A1 is 12. Quite simple. So now in the quiz, there will be more calculation along the chain, but the operation is still the same. So they will ask you, let's say, what is the expected utility of S1 knowing this distribution? So you can just progressively work it out from right to left, right? 12 times 0.1, 12, 10, 120, 120 times 0.1 is 12 here, 18, and combine these two, 0.2, yeah, just progressively moving downwards to get your 46. So this is a probabilistic action. You can see that I can go A1 or A2. There are different probability. But now let's say if they ask you for what action would I want to take, right? What action should I take? Then it will be, yeah, same calculation, but now we don't look at the probability anymore because we're choosing the action. Then we can see that, okay, action A1 give us 30 and action A2 give us 50. Then now it is a deterministic one. Like you can choose action A or B, A1 or A2. So now you only need to confine yourself into this section of the diagram to calculate the expected utility. So there is an expected utility attached to an action, and there's an expected utility attached to a state. Yeah, so the recall the idea, the various idea. There's a state, there's an action, there's a utility, and the utility can be attached to a state or an action. Okay, so there's this idea of discounted utility. So I'm not sure how it will be quizzed, but because it is one of the slides, then I just want to put it here for complete sake, right? The idea is quite simple. Let's say given the same reward, given the same value, would you want, I will give you 100 Singapore dollar right now. Do you want to want it now or you want 1 year later? Like 1 year later, I'm graduating, so I will not be here. So you cannot go and ask money from me. So you would want it now. So how do we express that idea of future uncertainty? Is we discounted it, right? If it's 1 year in the future, I will only think of it as like a 0.1 chance, for example. So in order to match the 100 Singapore dollar now, you need to give me more, let's say 1 million or like 10 million, right? In order to make it worth my weight, right? Yeah, so this is the idea of discounted utility. And there is a gem. So I think to be safe, if they ask you for a very long-winded calculation, they might have the equation there. You just need to know what to plug in, I think. Yeah. Okay, but back to the idea of the intuitive idea of a utility. So why do we come up with this idea of the utility? It's because in reinforcement learning, even though you know that we can identify them into state and action, the main problem still persists is that keeping track of them all is very computationally expensive. Like keeping track of your historical records of where you have been, what you have done is very expensive. So they come up with this idea of a utility to encapsulate the desirability towards a goal. Oh wait, why do I have duplicate? Sorry. Yeah. So it is to highlight the idea of a utility towards a goal. So they don't care about the previous state. They don't care what it has done before. Usually people will ask you, if you are to redo university again, like where would you go? Like CS or triple E, right? So that is one very interesting question that people might ask. But the assumption is that you still keep your memory. Like, oh, I go through 4 years of triple E, then if I do again, will I do it again with my memory intact? But then that's a cheat. So now the question here is, if you go back again with your memory wiped, what is your decision making? Right? What is the decision making process if you don't have your historical records? So that is why people come up with the idea of a utility. So the utility encapsulate the desirability towards the goal. So you can see that, like I draw this box, is the idea that if we are in state S1, we can only look so far into the future, S2 and S3. We don't really know what is our end goal. Like, we don't really know the nitty gritty details towards the goal. But we have a goal. We have some definition of goal. It's just that we don't know what happens in the middle. And what we can effectively assess is the next state. So this utility is try to encapsulate the general direction that you need to go. So in our case, university student, for example, let's say if our goal is to get money, then what is our utility question? So probably what is the expected salary, right? So you go to CS or triple E, I don't know where you end up, maybe big company, small company, SME, but the expected salary is something that you can use, right, to guide your decision-making process. So that is the same idea in reinforcement learning as well. So they don't keep track of your history. They don't have the memory of what you have done. But when they arrive at a state, they will see the expected utility and behave accordingly, choose the action accordingly. Okay, so now is, how does that even come about? What? How does that idea of expected utility can even come about? Is using this idea of a Bellman equation. An update. Okay. I will break this down into the various terms so that you can see what is happening here. So there is the current state utility. You have your reward. And then you have your discounted maximum utility of a certain action, right? Take action that get maximum expected value. And these are the expected value of the next state. A bit convoluted, but break it down again. Remember, we are always calculating the expected utility. So this sum over here, this sum PU, P is the probability. U is your utility of the state. So if you do the probability, you sum them up, you get your expected value of different action. Let's say if you have 10 different action, you will have 10 different expected value. And here you will only be taking the maximum utility. So that collapsed into one action, right? So if you take the action that give you maximum expected value, that will happen in the future. So you discounted it by a factor gamma. You discounted it by a factor gamma. Then you plus your reward RS, and that gives you the current expected value. Right. So let's say let's use our human example again. Right? Let's use our human example of CS and triple E again. Let's say. So the utility, so let's say we have two actions, CS or triple E, right? Then there's a probability and the utility. So let's say the utility is of, if you take CS, you have the probability of going to various CS related company, with the various utility, then it gets out a certain number. So for example, at the moment, you see that the computing and software development is quite heated, right? Everyone is CS, so now there's a bubble. Now the market doesn't need it anymore. But engineering is like, the chip making, all the maintenance, the manufacturing is still need to be there. So there's still demand. So now your triple E is suddenly more interesting, right? So you take the max, so based on the two utility, you will take the action that give you better ones. So let's say now maintenance, factory, still need to be upkeep. So there is a constant demand. So you will choose triple E. So you choose triple E. But then because your triple E degree is like 4 years in the future, so you discount it a bit. You discount it because it's in the 4 years. You don't know how your GPA will turn out, but you know that, you know, it should be safe there. But you discount it a bit. And then the reward is, you just got into university. Great job, 100 points. Then you plus your future utility if you go down the triple E route, which give you the current utility of where you are now. You just got to university. So using this calculation, you can see how the utility is calculated. Yes, and I hope that it will be useful in the quiz. I don't know if it will come out because it is in the slides, but from my experience, I think at most they will ask the expected utility. But to be safe, I elaborate on the Bellman equation. So what is the point of this utility? So from our example, I just demonstrate one step, right? From getting into university to getting a degree, which decision to make. But if the environment is very big, it's very vast, there are multiple ways to, you know, to live life. So how would one go about making decision? You can see that this is next state utility, and this is the current state utility. So using this equation, you can kind of like propagate your utility backwards, propagate the utility score further away from the goal, right? You have your goal, you have a certain goal. The utility signifies the path towards that goal. But if you are a child, you're quite, you know, uncertain, you don't know what to do, then this equation allows you to propagate that, the utility of the goal backwards. And yeah, and you may ask, okay, so why you take the maximum value? Because you generally want to do the best thing, right? Take max because you want to reach the goal with the best utility. Okay, yeah, so let's try and do this question. Yeah. Same as the example that I just said. So let's go and do this one. So you are given gamma is 0.5 and the reward is 5. Find the utility S of state S1. So you know S2, S3, S4, you know the probability, you know the action, then do the thing, right? Do the thing. Okay, let's do the thing. So for action A1, you will get 10 plus 9, right? It was 19. And for your A2 is just one state, so it was 20. So between A1 and A2, you would choose A2. So effectively, this taking the maximum, taking the action that give you the maximum utility, this is what the equation is saying. So you put it here because A2 is better. So now you have your gamma is 0.5. So after gamma, the whole thing becomes 10. After gamma, the whole thing becomes 10. Right. Yeah. So including the gamma, this is 10. Bigger. Green. Yeah. And then action. You have two A1 and A2 action, but you are taking the max. So this section here is a 20. Here is a 20. It's bigger a bit. Yeah. Then you add in the reward, which is 10 times 5 equals 15. 15. Yeah. So 15, right? So this is how you propagate the score, right? Backwards in time. So if on the right is in the future, then using this equation, you're like propagating it backwards and backwards and backwards. So this is a little bit more involved and complex than the pure utility up here, right? This, if they given everything, if they have given everything, if they have given all the probability distribution, all the probability distribution, then you can just propagate the move. But over here, if we are trying to be complete, like if we are trying to be complete, we have to take the maximum, take the discount, get the reward, and then give the final values, right? So the question now is, okay, but I see that there is P0.5 here, meaning that there are 50-50% chance of going A1 or A2, right? Which is true, right? Which is completely valid. But in this case, Oh wait, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Okay. There is a 0.5. Yes, correct. There is a 0.5. There is a 0.5. So let's say this is your PA1, right? This is PA1 times UA1. Right, correct. I'm sorry. Missed that out. So because A1 is 0.5 times. So PUA1 is 0.5 times 19, which give me 9.5. Right. Then now is PA2 times UA2 equals times 20, 10, right? Yeah, correct. Yeah, I missed out the 0.5. Correct. So you see P times U, and then when you have two values, you take the maximum, which is 10. Then now you discount, which is 5. Now 5 plus 5 is 10. Yeah. Correct. Okay. So now you know that the stake is, so it is more involved. It is in the lecture slide. So I go through it and complete it. But so far, I think no one has informed me of this happening in the quiz. So I think at most, they will ask for something like this up here, which is generally easier. And we hope it will be the same thing, right? It will be that as well. Okay. So now it is, technically, this is also in the slide, but I think that there is nothing much for them to quiz you about, because it is all words, so you cannot really calculate. But then if they are to ask you for, let's say, description or true and false, it is also generally good to know what is happening. So value iteration, so what does that mean? So recall that in our reinforcement learning, we want a policy as well. So the policy is the thing that actually improve over time, right? But in this case, there are various strategy. So our first strategy is value iteration. What does that mean is we just take the greedy policy, right? If you see two options, you take the one with highest value, that is greedy. So the greedy action is the same throughout. There is no improvement in the policy. So how would the agent improve in that environment then? The agent improve via using this Bellman equation to propagate the utility value backwards, like I said. So you can see on the left is new agent. The new agent is put into a new environment. It doesn't know anything. It doesn't know if this cell is 0 or 1 or whatever. It just knows that there is a goal. And if I go into the square next to it, there will be a punishment, right? So after a while, after it has explored, it will kind of know what is the utility value of certain square. So how is this being updated? it is being updated using this Spellman equation, right? You can see, yeah, this Spellman equation. So if everything is zero here, then you can kind of know that this is also zero. But if S2 is our goal state, right? If S2 is our goal state, this is one, this is minus one, then after a few rounds of calculation, that values will be propagated towards the adjacent state. So these values will be propagated backwards here, then backwards here, backwards here. Right, so that is how the run continues. That is how the agent that improve over time. It continuously run one episode from start to end, right? From start to end, the end condition might be that you fall down this pit and that is one end. That is the end of your run. But the idea is to run one time, run two times, run multiple times, then it will build out the best strategy to reach the goal. So you can see how, like we said, there is no history. Like, we don't remember what we have done so far. We don't have a history of our trajectory. But using the utility and that Bellman update equation, we can propagate the utility value back. So now what we are left is just a map of the utility landscape. We don't have to remember where we have been. We just need to know, here's the map, go here, go there. And another one is to both adjust the value and the policy. So what it means is, you can see that there's a diagram of a two edge. So there's a value and then there's a policy. So it will iteratively changing the policy. So if, for example, one policy can just be like going up all the time, like going up and up and up and up. But after you go up a few times and then you evaluate the utility of that run, it will be quite bad. So it has to adjust the policy accordingly. So this diagram is trying to say that as it improves the value, it will also improve the policy. It improves the value, it improves the policy, it improves the value, it improves the policy until we reach the star, which is the optimum value and optimum policy. You don't know how this has to work because yeah, it is out of scope, but it is something that you can know. So what is the difference between policy iteration and value iteration? Is that value iteration, you do this Bellman equation update, but you keep the policy to be greedy. This one, the policy can change and it also improves as you update, as you do the Bellman equation as well. So you don't need to know the math. You just need to know the tendency, the description. And this is how, yeah. So what is the policy? You might ask, what is this policy that you talk about? Like, it is mathematically expressed as pi. But what is pi? So pi can be a lookup table, right? Can be a lookup table, say that if I'm in state number one, I should go left. If I'm state number two, I should go right. It can just be simple as a lookup table. Or it can be a function. It can be a mapping. So a lookup table is mapping or neural network. So this is where your AlphaGo, AlphaZero, AlphaStar is better than human, is the idea of a neural network, right? I think your DSAI here, the first part, your supervised learning, your network, multi-layer perceptron, right? And this is where the magic happened. The magic happened at the, because it can change the policy and adapt itself to the environment. Yeah, so this is a fun, good to know component. So far, if we calculate, thanks. Yeah, thank you for answering the question. Yes, so far, anyone has any question? I think, right, the reinforcement learning part takes 30 minutes and it is quite heavy because of the nature of the subtopic, but in the quiz, probably like out of 25 days, it only occupies the last five, right? So, but then I hope it has been fruitful. I hope it has been encouraged you to explore more machine learning, deep learning, data science, and artificial intelligence. And if you're interested, you can also join back. Not join back, join MLDA. If you're already in, yeah, join back. If you're not, join us. Yeah, and do drop us a feedback so that we can keep continue to improve the session. So the policy is essentially the input where the value is the output. So the policy, no. So if you recall, feedback. About this. No, I cannot split. Everyone has anyone captured this? Yeah, so I will be showing the thing again some in a different slide. But the idea is that the policy takes in the state and output an action. And yeah, I hope everyone take the feedback form. So then I will go back here. Right. Oh, okay. Okay, so I will answer your question. And I think, can I ask everyone to come? Can or before you go, you can come. Can.
Look at which one. Okay. One more for the poll. Just in case I got a spot.
Yes. So the policy testing, can you hear me? Yes. So the policy is take in the state, right? It takes in the state and it output an action. So as it output an action, the environment will change and evolve into a state ST plus one. So now the input will be slightly changed. Then the agent will based on that new input. The agent policy will based on the new input to give it a action at AT plus one. Yeah.
Sorry, can
Oh,
I
and
hear?
oh, just now, or just now, I think you are asking the this policy iteration, right? So it is not that X policy is the input and value is the output, but the idea is they work together, right? So the actual input and output of the policy is the state and action. So state goes in the policy give out an action. This diagram is showing that as it performs that policy in the environment for about, let's say, 100 times, millions of times, it will improve the value function, the value the value function. Then with an improved value function, it will adjust its policy and then continue to do 100 to millions of try more in the world. And there is a policy function is up because policy function is argument utility function. I don't know then. Summation, what is a utility function? The summation part is the utility function is like it's more like the map, right? The map of the environment. So for example, on the right, it is a va is a u so this function is not an equation. I'm sorry. So the utility function. So this is an update step. The Bellman equation is an update step so that we can get this map, right? We can get the of utility attached to a certain states. Yeah, so when I said that this V, right? V here is signifying the map, the overall map of the environment. Which utility goes into which state? And this summation part is the summation is the root of it, right? It's ultimately the expected utility. It's just a calculation step.
And then this Bellman equation is like more refined version. It is a better estimation. I hope it answer your question.
Hello, can you hear?
Yeah.
How good can you say that I'm based on what he knows? So that is that. So it's a better deterministic policy. I mean, it's a better policy.
Yes, but I think if I'm not wrong, the A star component is like this, right? So the heuristic come from the straight line distance.
Yeah.
So this is a different. So this node, let's say for example, the graph here is trying to say that is a train distance via train, and you only operate on the train, but you can search with an information. Get from like a plane distance, straight line. Yeah. So which is you have more additional source of information. Whereas uniform cost search, you only know the cost, right? The cost so far. Here is like a potential benefit if you go in that direction.
Put it down to 140. All day. Then you add plane. Plane. Oh. They want to do it. So does it work like that? I like to do. So it is kept in memory, right? So you go here, you see three neighbors, then you know about these things, you keep them in your memory. Then when you go to Cebu, you have more information, you have three additional. This is the same thing, so you have three more. So in your working memory, you have five. Then now, for example, you go down to mini school, then expand more, but you still keep the memory of you have not explored.
You look at this, yeah, right? So you look at this. When we start out from here, when we start at the top, we expand to left and right.
But in that case, you continue going today.
You still keep the memory of the right because you have not explored that path. So you need information of that so that after you finish exploring down here, you can go back up and continue.
Yeah. Well, for example, it's already reached to this point. Then turns out that every point here is very expensive. This one is cheaper. Will it go that way or will it go further? Like, is there a limit where it won't look back?
So whether it looks back or not depends on the evaluation. Yeah, so like if they, at some point, let's say evaluation function goes to like 500, everything is 500, then it has to backtrack up and see if this fall. For so 50, you can get it anyway. Because ultimately, this is still like, it is guiding its decision. But ultimately, it has to take the train path. Like basically, it still has to search the train direction. It has to still operate from Arras to Bucharest in this train. The plane path is just a guiding principle.
At some point, it will be bigger. Power is enough
to the other. Right. But that assumes that it will not reach the Bucharest. So, for example, yeah. So, for example, there's between Vitesse and Bucharest, there's nothing. So, let's say the path just like clustering around. So, the plane distance is very short. It's just that it never reaches Bucharest. So, at some point, it's that there's no way, there's no way up. So it has to look back and
one.